Oana, I would like to welcome you all to Palmerston Library Theater. And I would like to thank two wonderful women, Iana Georgieva Kaluba, the librarian and the branch manager, Misuk Hedman, for enabling our poetry and music salons to find a beautiful home and for promoting this event throughout the library system. These salons are a gift to all of you, to the thriving poetry and music community in Toronto. And we are here to support each other, to be all that we can be. So welcome to the September 2016 Poetry and Music Salon. We've just moved to a new time slot, the last Saturday afternoon of every month, 2 to 4 p.m., and I'm booked right through to the end of June. So we have fabulous features today. Michael Mirolla, Linda Stitt, Karen Lee, and Kirk Felix. Our first one is a fabulous musician and friend, Jim McCuaig. Welcome, Jim.
Well, I'm going to lead in because I don't know who this is adjusted for. There's an old joke about how sportsmen give their families the most expensive food in the world, and it's not because the food is that much higher cost, because all the money they had to spend on the equipment to get it. So in the same spirit of the thing, you know, we drove 4.5 hours today to give our 5 minutes. Favorites. I have a little concoction of that. Thank you. by 5 minutes. Thank you very much.
So much, Jim. That was fabulous. Oh, missed you. Music. So next is Jennifer Hosein. Because we're tight for time, I'm not doing a lot of introductions. Jennifer's been a friend for a number of years. She's an artist and a poet, and she's one of my favorite people. Welcome, Jennifer.
Thanks, Brenda. Does this thing come down a little? No? That's okay. I can figure it out. This is a bit of a new venue for me. This is my second time here. Brenda and I go back a little bit. I'm going to do a few new pieces here and one slightly older piece. This first one is my daughter moved away to Los Angeles and got married, and I thought she was gone forever. She's not, she's back, but it was a long time. I was pretty devastated. Yeah, that's better, right? Okay. Oh, thanks. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, that works. This is called Wedding Day. You are the princess beneath my pillow. I am the pea that sways in the corners of your night. You are my map of the city. Every place is only meaningful in the way that you were there with me. This is the airport that you are leaving me from. This is the road that takes you away, that takes me away from you. When you leave, you take the light away. I wait for your whisper, hold tight to the pillow that you laid your head upon as if it were love itself. I pull stitches out of your discarded dresses, unraveling the years between us. Then I begin to sew your wedding dress, the threads of my loneliness tangled with tears. Across the universe in a sun-bleached room, I lay the snow-white dress on the bed. Today is your wedding day. You tug at the hem of your dress, dip your white heels into the grass, guests melting in the Hollywood afternoon. You are breathtakingly happy. In the morning, I have to return to my life without you. I press my tears to the door of your hotel room to feel your breath. When I look for you in mirrors, you shine behind my eyes. Sometimes you whisper me to wrap you tight in the star-punched night. The next piece is it's called Ink. In the mornings, my fingers were stained the color of the ink that I used to write you into my dreams. Sometimes you were black ink handprints along the walls. Canvases of you were propped up around my life, blocking the real and putting it into its place, a semblance of you. By the spring, I had so many canvases that you began to appear as a man, breathing and soft-mouthed, reclining on my bed. I could not tell real from writing, skin from paint. This is a couple more little pieces. This is Road. I open for you on the road, fill my car up with wet longing, pinch me, bend me, let me suck you up with my hands, swallow you with my eyes, yearn with my tongue, up and down the twisted night. I am so far from home on this road that winds and bends through snow and stars. How will I find my way back? And one last piece. I've read this a lot of times, so I don't know, you might have heard it. My mother had heart surgery a few years ago, and then followed by two strokes. This is about my mother's heart. Heart. My mother's heart begins to drift away, but we are selfish and tell her to let them fix it. And we pace and pace the days. Don't tell her it's a poor sign, aortic valves open and close, that keeps her herself until she is not herself, voice crooked, face fallen, buttons askew, and pants half on the floor. I cannot begin. Beloved mother is a clipped winged bird that floats around in lace-edged nightgowns, soft, soft skin like a schoolgirl's, shooing away the cats and always packing her clothes to go home. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Jennifer. And next is Daniela, who I know from Urban Gallery, where I was invited to do these poetry and music salons originally a few years ago. So welcome, Daniela.
Hello, everyone. I'll be reading from the Mississauga Writers Group anthology, in which I have 13 poems published, and we're also excited to have our 2016 anthology just launching. I will begin with Whispering Voice. Echoing voice, distantly heard, past the dried trees over decadent soil. Whispering voice creeps over my ear like a coiling lizard nesting over its concoction. Curious voice draws me right in, off my path, into sudden darkness. Friendly voice serenades my name through cooled breath to breathe in and choke on. Pleading voice calling me over for a promised treat in the soil cracks. Impatient voice, for time is pressing, a slapping tail, tapping claws. Furious voice, wailing in my head, tugging at my feet, showing its face. Utter silence creeps over my ears, like morning kisses, muted in final flashbacks. Sorry. Predestined. She's the current-take and jellyfish who drags along her tentacles, each heavily memory-filled, and she drags them on and on, slowly, wary to keep off, for they will sting even her touch. She's the bride dragging her train, like fingers scratching the floor, to grab hold and stop her feet from reaching the wrong altar. But on and on she drags it still, for the door behind has shut. He is all the weighing memories that still burn her bearing chest. He is the solemn standing iceberg that won't budge an inch her way. So he bears the sun rays heat, for his trek has long been halted. He is the one who shut the door, straightening her train, whispering go. He is the weeping willow by the lake, soon to slide and sink right in, like terrain thus collapsing, for his roots have long sunken. And I am the ocean current that won't change my course. I am the stinging memories that won't be forgotten. I am the altar's one-way aisle that won't change the groom. I am the weight halting his trek that won't take him back to her. I am the lake swallowing him that won't change my tide. I am the one who whispered go that won't undo my casted curse. Their fate I ended, as did mine. And just one last. Backstage blend. You can't see me like this. I'd never let you see the backstage before the entrance, all blush and rouge, dabbed on and popped. I'll never be able to fix these coffee-stained eyes, nor could any powder hide all of those ears. You see them right here, and you rub them in. I'm better off lip-licking and cheek-pinching, coffee-quitting, force-smiling, slowly, genuinely smiling. A piece of my soul through a slit in the curtains. Where has yours been, your soul stasis and lone, playing the wise sage while mine tugged on for yours to join mine and blend into a blonde, removing the milk, the sugar, the cream, and all of the stings we sipped onto daily? A pure black blend savored backstage. Thank you.
Thank you, Daniela. Now, somebody I don't know, whose work I haven't heard before, but I've heard wonderful things about your work, Jovan.
Thank you. I'm back in Toronto. I've been on the road with my poetry for the last 4 years, Western United States, last 2 years in California. I published this book of poems, Narcotica, there. And I'll do two poems from Narcotica. First poem is a poem of introduction. It's entitled Deviant Melody. I am a silver-tongued devil, godless shaman, thief of fire, provocateur, lawless renegade on the road to perdition, blasphemer at the gates, conscience of the exception, oracle of the absent present, wildflower seed, deviant melody, original voice deep within the sacred body hidden, song ecstatic, irrational, erotic, whispering incantations, seductions into every sleepy ear, pied piper of the Delta tribes, uplifter of nightmare scenarios, nomadic madmen, defiant minstrel marauders of the unsaid, forever questing vigilant vagabond, serenading desert solitary, wandering exile in a garden of mortal flowers, agile dancer leaping precipices of abysmal absurdity, primordial pain pleasure principle, ancient lover of the infinite intimate, embracing prisoners fleeing the wilderness of echoes. And the next poem is entitled The Way of Orphans and Exiles, and this is commentary on United States. Guns, guns, guns! Cage, rage, scar bars, muse in the news, and boss on the cross. From New York to Nepal, rooftop voyeurs leapfrogging the star-spangled seventh heaven. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Nausea, nausea, politicians of all stripes hustle their wares. Armies in Armani spit and swear. Dogma meltdown, global breakdown, obscene wealth, toxic stealth, business as usual for corporate whores reflecting fear in the media mirror as past, future time seek reason rhyme in glaring virtual present. Vision, revision, collide in symbol. Art on the run races madly ahead of the dread. And the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air. Designer labels, celebrity labels, money, 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 dollar muscle, profit jocks, reciting beats, hot off streets, good cop, bad cop, razzmatazz, bikini cat, alto sex, jazz, hot tin cats killing time, lies, lies, lies from fractured minds. Hollywood ending, good guys winning, no problem. Am I sure? Sure, I'm sure. As sure as there's gaz in my pizzazz, day and daydream, lay and layman, who can tell? Lower the rope and scream out the L. 6 days on rockabilly's broken string. Look, look, bully boys, white noise, static in your attic, what's cooking in your kisser, Maybelline? I hope it's high up on wishing well, not bourgeois in between. The cream, the cream. Will somebody, anybody pass me the cream? Spinning, spinning, planet spinning, winners lose, losers winning, global billions unawares, all that's sacred blinks and stares. Wait, a new way opens. Aux âmes citoyennes, formez vos bataillons. Together now, destination emancipation. So many insights birthing on our tongues today, flinging flat stone focus slaps the surface of consciousness, way out there on the outskirts of imagination, way, way out there. Oh, Canada. Lips burning with vows of passionate fire, irreverent laughter exploding through unhinged brains. Cloudy midnight thunder, igniting deep dark night with electric spirit, primal bodies dancing, leaping, lifting off this heavy earth, flying into the unseen, unspoken, singing smile of destiny, heart of grace, amour fati.
Thank you.
Wow, thank you, Jovan. And you know, I was going to do a spot, and I think that what I'm gonna do would follow very well from that. So this was just published. My publisher's here, Michael Mirolla. It will be launched December 4th. That was amazing. So I'm going to do some difficult pieces, and they're kind of in the center. It's one of the cruxes of the book. And I'm gonna do 5 pieces, but a bunch of them are really short. Exile. Those of whom I speak, monsieur, are embedded in grammars too. As syntaxes and lexicons with unique verbal patterns, we are bound in the grammar of a relationship which shapes us. The man who teaches pedagogy says what we must never do: patronize, reduce, laud, ridicule, dismay, simplify, bowdlerize, censure, or censor. Wield discourse as spectacle. Wield discourse as power. Wield discourse contemptuously, or silence each other. We humiliate those we exile. By ignoring them, we remove their voice. If we refuse to listen, they cannot speak. If they cannot speak, they will not be heard. We have created a hole in the grammar of the connection which divests the speaker, who we did not want to hear, of a speaking voice that is heard. I know, monsieur, it happened to me, and you'll have to buy the book to find out what happened. Sorry. Unspeakable, not speaking. Speechless, we speak, the making mute. If we don't hear each other, how can we listen? And potistas, power? Power, the ability to do. Power, having others believe. We watch ourselves with internalized surveillance. How are we shaped by that which we wish to be accepted by? Specter. She walks the seawall, a parade of black, coats, pants, dresses, and flashes of red. Her white face, the black hair, and lurid red lipstick, a specter. When she gazes at us, beating warmth of our blood, we cannot escape our unblinking eyes. And this is a Derrida quote. The straining eye always resembles the eye of the blind, sometimes of the dead. In that precise moment when morning begins, it is still open. A pious hand should soon come to close it. It would recall a portrait of the dying. The woman in black trails the seawall. Her hair, its tendrils and curls, coil in the sea spray. She turns us to marble. Pale green veins in the rock. And splatters us with red, the color of her fingernails. The Gorgon creates a cast of unmoving characters, her silent companions. She laughs at my drained creativity. I know this woman, the blood drains from my lips. I am silenced, I mute, unspeaking. Stony glance. The sea wall, my inner lashing waves, salt tears. Her parrot, cinnabar, and virid feathers mocks, endlessly repeating the soulless words on the salt spray while she laughs. It is, we are. I want to become a tidal wave, but I withdraw. Describe the figure of jealousy of derision? Is jealousy an overweening desire to upstage the other, to cast them out, stones of silence? I evade her stony glance with questions. Thank you. So our next 5-minute former feature spot is Karen Shenfeld. You hear Karen? Welcome, Karen.
Well, my partner Jim and I just blew into town a few minutes ago, and I was a few minutes late because I was actually dealing with something to do with my mother's estate, and I think her name is Jennifer, read a poem about her mom's heart, And like many people of my generation, we're dealing with the death and sickness of our parents and all that means. So my mother passed away in July. So I decided to read a couple of poems for her. Mother's Hands. Standing out from vellum paper skin, the veins, teal tributaries flow against gravity. The skin drawn loose from knuckles, knotted joints, a glove one size too large, but free of liver spots. She's proud of this. I stroke the creased translucence of my mother's hands. Their softness pricks and burns. Their trace of English lavender, foreign, bittersweet. She's tucked away her wedding rings, too tight for years, dear. Dawn's shopping channel bling. Once naked, sensibly clipped, her oblong nails are long, their gibbous moons rising unseen beneath two coats of glowing meet me at sunset red. My mother's hands alight on the tops of her thighs as she perches on her vanity chair, the bent twigs of her fingers dry as kindling. My own are her spare pair. Look, the same foreshortened fingers, spur of bone persisting beyond the right wrist. As I button her buttons, lace her laces, brush her hair, and wonder, what do her hands remember? When she's asleep, do they mime working knife and fork, needle and thread? Do they hover over a nocturnal piano, the black and white notes sounding without touch? Do they wave goodbye? Do they fly? As once backlit by a bulb's bared light, thumbs linked, fingers outstretched, her hands winged over flowers, blooming wildly on my bedroom wall. All the time in the world. Will we go for a manicure in heaven? Will we sit like this in deepening blue, side by side at petite lacquered tables above mute clouds, the highest jet? We'll have all the time in the world in heaven. The angels of beauty shall attend us, their hummingbird wings invisible as they hover in mid-thin air to paint each of our nails a different hue. In heaven, our nails won't break, nor our polish chip. Our hands ever soft inside belt sleeves. Thank you.
This is some really wonderful poetry this afternoon. So welcome, Sharon Goodier. Sharon and I have known each other 35 years?
Yes.
Actually, for the sake of posterity, it's Goodier. It's what the Welsh did to Gautier. There was a mass exodus of Gautiers from France in the early 1700s, and a lot of them ended up in Wales. And since the Welsh love double letters, they changed Gautier into Goodier.
My heart is not a bus. I am a Volkswagen, compact, economical, engine in front, storage in rear. Driven by a thirst for justice, a compassion for all sentient beings, empathy neurons hanging out the window like a dog's tongue. So much suffering, injustice, racism, sexism, ethnic cleansing of Palestinians, terrorists killing non-believers, bombs, guns, beheadings, armies killing civilians in the name of stability, whole populations hung out to dry, washed out, tattered laundry, permanent stains. My head, oh my head, splits with the choices. Who deserves to live or die or be forever illiterate? Who will be my passengers in the back seat, the front, as I drive into a future soaked in blood, ripe with the smell of a civilization dying by its own hand? Many have given up. No gas, blown out tires. Your heart may not be a bus, but it can be a van. You are not alone. Embrace a paradigm shift. See the world differently. Suffer with refugees, prisoners, the homeless, those with mental health challenges, victims of war. Not all of them. Investigate, select, find others who feel the same, form or join a group, work together. Choose what gives you energy, focus your spirit. Believe the Talmud, you are not required to complete the task, neither are you free to abandon it. Our shared humanity engenders this. Open the doors of your van. I read this the last time I was here, and I read the wrong version, so I got the right version this time. Moonwalker. Outside a vegetable store on two overturned crates, we wait for other protesters at the Office of Indigenous Affairs, formerly known as the Indian Office. Beside me on her crate, middle-aged Moira talks continuously. When I was six, government agent, government helicopter, picked me up like a package, flew me south to residential school. They called me Moira to erase my heritage, My real name means moonwalker because I love to walk in moonlight and wanted to be an astronaut. Took me miles and miles from my family and home to erase my tribal roots, long hair cut, clothes trashed, replaced with everything blue, pants, turtleneck, shoes, and a school uniform, also blue, and black dress shoes. Moonwalker talks about today's groceries, root vegetables, carrots, zucchinis, squash, and wild rice, packed neatly on her back, and that leads to talk about a marriage and a family bereft of desire. I watched my children fall into hopelessness, dreams melt into the shadows on cold winter nights, a treeless land stretching forever under a white blanket. You know the fishing season is short, Takes the lives of men who drink homemade whiskey to keep warm. She talks about yesterday's housework, small brick house, four families, her turn to pick up, put away, knitting, unfinished homework, empty cups. I wash dirty dishes with bottled water bought with money needed for food. Back home day before yesterday, I waited 3 hours at the clinic for a toothache. Doctor flies in only three times a week, I can almost feel her bad tooth. No dentist, tooth pulled, no anesthetic. I flew south with the others to protest these living conditions, plane donated by a group of galleries that sell tribal art. I stew, anger in me comes to a boil over a still growing fire. How did this happen? Leaders, politicians, they knew and they did nothing. Did it in my name, your name, as my elected representatives, your elected representatives. Failure to provide the necessities of life, a crime under the criminal code if you do it to your own children. Moonwalker continues, 1979, last residential school closes, I am 12. Returned to an isolated community, resettled 30 years ago, after government steals traditional land so they can extract oil. But they never found any, Never put us back, neither. I had years of longing to leave, to stay, to survive, thrive. No running water, Barely enough electricity to read or do homework. As she speaks in my mind, I can see even the tungsten quivering in shame. She wraps up quickly as the other protesters arrive with drums. On cloudless nights when the moon was up, the snow outside my window burst with diamonds. I dreamed of gathering them, cashing in, buying a plane, eh? To fly out of here to where people better than us, who have everything, would sell it to us so we could be better too. Only now I've been here and I know better.
And I'm absolutely delighted that Karen Lee has come out to feature. You're gonna love her. And so our second set is going to be all our fabulous features. And our first set was all fabulous poets, who many of whom have featured here, and the rest of you will feature here, I can guarantee it, with some wonderful poetry this afternoon. She's an amazing singer, poet.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming out on a Saturday afternoon. It's good to see you all. Good to see some of my friends who are here as well. Side Road Swamp. My friend and I went to a lavender farm this summer. All we wanted to do was drown in the scent of purple. We got there, and the lavender fields were scentless. The only place we smelled lavender, was in the gift shop. On our way out, we came across a side road swamp. That little piece of heaven inspired this piece. Where roads are called side or concession, bark arms sway, praise summer sky. Dark green glass ripples, frogs, dragonflies, birds unseen, answer roll call. Sharp sounds whistle, strings in tiny throats. Laden creatures bellow, hide in weepy green drapes. Curled leaves embrace brown frog, half dipped in swamp. Rod of aged earth floats hot mist. Thin tree pins mulch island in place. What holds me, no leaf beneath, untethered, living only this? Faceless maestro, breath of seen, unseen, leads the silence, fugue of browns, greens, caw, splash, bubble burst, rustle, whistle, ribbit, splash, veiled flight, swoosh, whirl, birds, plead, coax, flirt. New friends breathe together as old. Red car rests between hot tar and marsh. More intrigue here than scentless lavender feels. I share poetry. She lives photography, perched on random tree stump. Leans precariously, captures curve, line, reflection of masterpiece through lens less perfect than her eye. Keen sight, ears cocked, pores wide, hold visual soundscapes, later frame in words unequal to lyrical interval of time inimitable. We laugh, marvel, inhale with skin, swallow swamp whole, suspended. Thank you. I've been asked to extend my set, so I'm going to include a poem called Sightings. I received a Facebook post and it said something to the effect of, what is meant for you will never miss you. What misses you was never meant for you. Not sure if I wholly believe that. Like perhaps some of you, there may be the one who got away. And this is a poem about coming around to meeting ourselves in love. I thought I saw you today, fabled prince who got away. Forbidden fruit scored my then best friend. Girl code says you're somewhat taboo, even though you're long since finished. So handsome, established and graying now, Heart lifted, I lost 10 pounds, raised my center off the ground, flew into fantasies of wedding to help me forget. I forgot myself, led astray in long enough to scar. Cold mirage sears my heart within an inch of dying. I went salsa dancing in hopes I'd find you pulsing the beat of the clave rhythm. Inflated, I sailed ripe musk of my tail feather. When the cock twirled me like red ribbon, sailing your eyeline through bobbing heads. On chimichum-chum, my eyes slid down long brown curls, wrapping white face and mouthful of sugar cubes beaming back at you. I lost my altitude, but let a mask remain. Shallow smile holds familiar shock, bracing rejection at least 500 years old. Deflated, but every now and again, my bird song still faintly rings when I imagine that she's dead. Was that you on the corner of tea cake and obinze? Ah, the rolling dance of tight hips on long muscled legs. Strong wrists display a rack of artful fingers, a storied face pleasing and mild. Those doe eyes shone too slick, wet, waiting to drown me in lust without end, as you would the very next, with two breasts, fringed cleft, and a face that you could stand. Green light said, go, take the road traveled less. Impatient drivers honked amens. I fled that intersection of hope and injury, dry, free, and still lonely. Then there's you. You dim my view every now and again, retreat just before my eyes raise to cut. You lurk just long enough to remind me of a plate of lukewarm fundraiser food with an odd stranger out of town in a rental you almost crashed into a sidewalk pole that wouldn't move. I'd really rather forget how you can't find your weight in relation to other nouns. Women are only compasses you stalk to map your bearing. That one date, awkward splinter on a canvas of lonely nights. How hungry must I have been? Only at another free Japanese aga did I absorb the loudness of your mechanical mouth crushing popcorn into bits. That subtle rocking I had missed formed shadows for your ghosts over there on the other side at 2 o'clock if I am 8. In the frame of my enlightened eyes, I hurried to rewrite my own story, deepening character development in me and other people's scent, refining the gift of discernment. I have not since been on a date, but I am alive, alone, and safe, and for now, that's all that matters. I thought I saw you on line one. Comet offering another glimpse, renewing chances to love I missed. Gold lava flowed from your eyes. You stopped my breath in the glowing embrace of that question. I got too close to those beautiful suns. My own brilliance frightened me, melted my wingspan. Plumed shoulders raised to receive the compromise, my face nestled down in tufted bed. When I crash-landed, my eyes gazed instead at the fallen arch of a subway foot in summer. Leather straps bind mangled toes in need of moisture and filing. Thank you. I am a singer and I have sung hundreds of weddings. What I had not done until this summer was perform commissioned wedding poems. This next piece is one such poem for Andrew Tay and Edwige Jean-Pierre. Andrew Tay occasionally does play guitar for me, which is fabulous. I found a musician. This poem is called Until. What inspired it was just observing how they look into each other's eyes a little too long and they go somewhere. Don't know where it is, but I just saw that over and over and I thought, okay, got it. Until. You disappear behind shiny eyes, in whirls beneath skin. Swim stories coursing bone, hold the other in love gaze. Fluid, freeing, strong as silk. Morning hope, sharp lilac mist. Ancestors drum wedding news through dimension where you first knew. Beyond body of light and sound. In the span of a kiss, I become a piece of sand. Two flames of red and blue shiver the ocean, bleed purple the night sky, hold lover's silt as pulsing rubies in moon's light. No secret scorned, no wound unloved, only love gaze, fluid, freeing, strong as silk, morning hope, sharp lilac mist. Two waves recede, again collide, twist away, arch back, collapse, flicker, swell, blaze, widen soft tissue slack. Sea life stirs, birds stop mid-flight. Leaves seize crisp gossip. Goddess rolls, knowing I as you sway. Weave, grunt, gush. Grow love in warm honeyed light. You disappear from the room behind shiny eyes. To whirls beneath skin, sudden contours joined in flight to underwater paradise. In the span of a kiss, I become a pearl of dew. Only love gaze remains between you, fluid, freeing, strong as silk. Morning hope, sharp lilac mist, soft as breath. Echo of promise pressed in round, as sure as water, light, sound, until. Thank you so much. Whitney French runs a workshop called Writing While Black. And this next piece called Flight was birthed from a 10-minute exercise with the prompt, "They came like caged birds." I would like to dedicate it to the immigrants, migrants, refugees, our mothers, families, friends who came here to Turtle Island. Flight. Weighted songs, wings forgotten, lethargy of unused tendons, hope thickens blocked throats, eyes receive images flatly, searching only vast freedom, riding blues on winds unbonded, ever missed. The ever-missing shells whisper former majesty, push upright hard against the will of those they owe. far more than they possess. New borders they cannot forget, cradle-fisted priorities. Fractioned lives, tightly mortgaged, leaving nothing dear to borrow save the very space they rent, minus stretch of thin shadow. These are they who came quickly, beached fish delirious for clear, soft air. Curled backs shun blood-spattered dreams, only to lose their tongues here. The next song ties into this piece. Those of you who follow my performances know I love to sing poems. And the songs I sing generally tend to be poems in and of themselves. This is a prize-winning poem by William Waring Cooney, a Harlem Renaissance poet, friend of Langston Hughes. He wrote it when he was 18 years old. It is the most anthologized poem of the 20th century from African American literature. Nina Simone helped make it popular, of course, and when she sang it, she would preface it with a tribute to the Caribbean women who came to America as servants, who would not know their beauty due to the system of white supremacy and the brutality under which they lived. The song is called Images, from the poem, No Images. She does not know her beauty. She thinks her brown body. She thinks her brown body has no glory. If she could dance naked under palm trees and see her image in the river, she would know. Yes, she would know. There are no palm trees in the street, no palm trees in the street. And dishwater gives back no image. She does not know her beauty. She thinks her brown body has no glory. If she could dance naked under palm trees and see her image in the river, she would know. Yes, she would know, yes, she would know. There are no palm trees in the street,
dishwater gives back no image.
Thank you, Brenda Clues. Thank you, everyone. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Stunning, Karen. Thank you so much. Beautiful. Wow. Okay. So we are very fortunate. Our next fabulous poet is Linda Stitt, one of the most beloved poets in Toronto. Welcome, Linda. She does a words and music salon at Vino Rosso the first Saturday of every month, so it's next Saturday. So.
Thank you, Brenda. Thank you all. I can't see, but thank you whoever's here. And I'll start out with my always starting out poem. It's called Time Out. We were always one. There was only one. There never was anyone else. But just to make the sport more scary, we played at the game of solitary and hid ourselves in mysteries swathed in our separate histories and dreamed of finding one. But it was always one. One hung upon the cross. One sat beneath the Bodhi tree, and one was bad, and one was good, and one was all there'll ever be, shaman and cynic, sinner and saint. Behind the mask, beneath the paint, beyond the blade of arbitrary time, there has been one, integral and sublime, being whatever, however, whoever it chose to be. Being you, being me, being itself in myriad manifestation. And not to spoil the game, but just to have a moment's celebration, let's recollect with love and jubilation that we are one. This is called Unbinding. Lying on the table, I wait and watch my breath as the doctor slits open my breast. I disappear into the tip of my nose as he punches three holes into the tumor. They show me the results in formalin, little worms that were and are not me. What would I have to excise, I wonder, or whittle away? Which of the 32 parts must be forfeited before I am no longer me? Or what is this aggregate that is a self? On purpose, we are the sense organs of the cosmos, at the fractal edges of an ever-expanding universe. Through us, God comes to know itself, to learn, to change, to grow in glory. We have arisen in the interweavings to lend our colors, our perceptions, our uniqueness to the pastiche of totality, the Salmagundi of the unformed. You bring your singular flavor to the feast. No need to question your purpose. It is simply to be who you are. Perfection perfecting. We do not tell a mountain how it ought to be. We do not should a sunset. And you, you snowflake expression of the splendor of creation, are as faultless a manifestation of the wonder of totality. Perfection is not static. The spiritual sun is always on the rise. The universe unfolds from glory to glory. We all give what we can, receive what we need to move us through the endless realization of ourselves. Mother love has brought us hither. Father love will take us hence. We are here to learn our nature, to celebrate the magnificence of love's outpicturing. We will not count our shortcomings, number our faults, dishonor our beauty with criticism, and, aspiration notwithstanding, with evolution inevitable, we are in this moment emanations of the irreproachable source. Swaha. Beyond the soft swoosh of the wind, the hum of the refrigerator, the chattering static of the television, the raucous party conversation, beyond the horns at midnight, the beat of island music, beyond the greatest symphony, beyond the whine of the cicada, the chirp of the sparrow, the whisper of a falling feather, beyond all sound, real or imagined, the crackling of the stars, the droning churn of galaxies, beyond even the echoes in my head, the psalms, the hymns, the chants, the mantras, beyond the farthest reaches, the shores on which all ripples come to rest. There is the silence, which is the voice of my beloved. Ceremony. Sit sideways to the drum and show respect. This is a culture far older than your own, and its sacred is unfamiliar to you. The words are spare but fraught, and the pipe is not frivolous. You will be healed where you are oblivious to wounds, and you will weep with no sorrow. Sit without judgment or criticism. Do not filter the teaching through a self. Listen in the interstices. The silence is as profound as the song. Natural medicine. Give me no more cruelty. Show me soap operas about compassion, movies about joy, musicals about equanimity. Gladden my heart with kindness. Cruelty is a poison. Even unintended, it wounds more deeply than we think. So be aware. It warps generations. Be even more aware. Our planet is dying of cruelty. Our species extinguishes itself with ill will. I have seen and done too much of cruelty. We have always had the power to heal. The antidote is love. This one's called for Peter. Ciao. You came to me like spring, gently at first, almost imperceptibly, then in a warm rush melting the crystals at the center of my waters, cascading through my arteries and veins, singing along my nerves and nadis, curling a liquid longing up my spine, awakening me to senses and to seasons. Now I am resurrected. I dress myself in the fluid kiss of silk and bear myself to the winds licking my limbs. I am open to summer's sensual embrace and the lingering encirclement of autumn. Each thrust of beauty penetrates where ice once armored me against nature's insistence. I yield now to the heat of my own essence. The forever winter which I thought was upon me will not come as long as your fingertips love my skin, as long as your memory floods my flesh, as long as I do not forget your promise of always. C note. There is little to hope for, I thought, except a miracle. And then I thought, a miracle is supposed to be wonderful. But it didn't look so good to the Egyptians. Song of the Frigid Woman, or Baby, It's Cold Inside. Oh Lord, please give me an impotent man. I enjoy a good hug whenever I can, but celibacy is my ultimate plan, so give me an impotent man. He could be taking some strong medication that dampens his drive, or have some combination of injury, age, ennui, or castration. Just give me an impotent man. I haven't completely abandoned romance. I just choose to relate where there isn't the chance stepping out might involve stepping out of my pants. So give me an impotent man. No thrill in the masculine member I find since my worn-out libido just up and resigned. But I love intercourse with the masculine mind, so give me an impotent man. The truth must be told, and the facts must be faced. No man in his prime or his senses would waste a moment in chasing the forcibly chased. So give me an impotent man. Oh, Lord, please don't send me some lusty young buck, because I'm concerned with my usual luck. He'd want conversation. I'd want conversation, and he'd want to physically express his affection. So give me an impotent man. Remains. They have been whittling away at me, a slice here, a chunk there, digging out bits and pieces like vultures hunched over the juiciest organs. Leave the eyeballs till last, I say. I want to see what's going on. Epiphany. Last week, as I passed beneath the branches of a budding maple tree, I was struck square atop the head by a liquid pigeon dropping. I think it was a pigeon. By the time I looked up, remembering dilatorily to close my mouth, the culprit had vanished too quickly for a positive identification. I stood for a moment blotting my pate with a Kleenex and then resumed my walk, pondering the cosmic import of the incident. What are the odds, I wondered, against this particular concatenation of step and sphincter? I am aware that such an occurrence is considered fortunate by some. Is this mere superstition, or in this case, a significant phenomenon? Am I a lucky shithead? Or simply an avian latrine? Is this a heavenly fertilization that will nurture some meaningful growth, some momentous expansion? In which case, is all the shit in my life a forerunner of wisdom, a harbinger of insight, a compost for consciousness? I have explored, examined, contemplated, and concluded that this was a spiritual wake-up call, a celestial reminder that even the unlikeliest event serves to ring the bell of the Dharma. Dung. That's it? Okay, thank you so much. Thank you, Brenda.
Well, Linda, you were wonderful and entertaining and brilliant as ever. Our final poetry feature is a very special man, Michael Mirolla. When he took over Guernica Editions some years ago, he's pretty much turned it into a publishing powerhouse. He publishes 30 titles a year, which is almost unheard of, and apparently he reads pretty much everything that comes in. I don't know how he does it. Plus, he publishes a book of his own almost every year, and he's an award-winning writer and poet. His own work is brilliant. So I would really like to welcome Michael Mirolla.
Yeah, perfect. Thanks, Brenda, and thanks for inviting me to the salon. It's, I see it as an essential combination of poetry, song, and music. It's an unusual as well. I just like to read some poetry from my two collections, and then some from a collection that I'm working on right now, called Repositories. The first poem is from my first collection, Light and Time. The Art of Walking. The roadkill rises, eyes rimmed in red. The raccoons, the rabbits, the rats, and you. We dwell on the edge of somewhere, like angels, perhaps, flirting between possibilities, like angels, maybe, licking each other's wounds. A gaunt cow stands knee-deep in a subdivided field, stares out in the fervent hope of slaughterhouse, that quick, clean cut to the jugular. Here the signs come fast and furious. Whoops, you've just missed Camelot, an exclusive enclave for the millionaire in each of us. Sheep manure for sale, by appointment only. Call art. The highway leans hard into the wind, its dull roar like a grinding machine for the future. It spits out godliness, detached housing, luminosity, evergreen rugs, one-legged flamingos stalking the elusive fast food wrapper, cars snapping at the heels of brittle corn stalks. The highway leans hard into the wind. Behind it, civilization's stubborn convoy. Impressions of faces against taut plastic, crucifixes around the necks of mourning doves, vacuum sealed. In the distance, the hills continue to ovulate. The trees strain against their leashes. The windmills ride off half-cocked. The snakes, the skunks, the squirrels are rising. And you? We live on the edge of nowhere, in a quiet cul-de-sac. We reside on the edge of nowhere, in a quiet cul-de-sac. The sign at the end of the street, roadkill ahead. The next two poems are from my second collection of poetry called The House on 14th Avenue. Karen and was it Jennifer had a poem about their mothers and at a certain time of our lives, and this one's about my father. Profumeria. At the age of 95, my father decides on the need for cologne. The traces hover long after he has shuffled by, fresh, bracing, effervescent, odor. A perfect cover, I guess, for the cracked vellum skin beneath. He splashes it on in the space where parchment and spillage meet each morning before a mirror image he can barely see. And he is morphing, more comfortable of late with face childlike and gummy than with ill-fitting dentures inserted. They rattle inside his mouth, click-clacking in their painful song to entropy. At the age of 95, my father, fearful of vanishing, gropes the dark spaces for something to do. His fingers ripple against the waves of gravity before him, less visible yet thicker each passing day. He probes tax bills and hot pepper jars alike, pokes at sweet grapes that trail a nasty stain like ancient bruises, like the purple marks left by prison camp guards. In the sunlight that streams through the living room window, I see the dust that will carry him off one day. One day. But in the meantime, he reaches gingerly for the blue-tinted bottle and dabs himself and the world around him with more than a hint of scented blessing. I can but think of singing the sun in flight and imprecations against an easy dark. And this one's also for people of a certain age, I guess. Occult slide test. I settle on my haunches, staring at a piece of myself in a plastic container that once boasted light ricotta, soft, unripened cheese with 50% less fat, whey, milk, cream, lactic acid, salt, carrageenan, locust bean gum, guar gum. Now it holds a small, round, elongated piece of myself, bile pigments, mucus, unabsorbed minerals, undigested fats, cellulose, meat protein toxins, peeled off cells, potassium chloride, sodium bicarbonate, water. I squat here thinking of substance and substrata, the slow hiss of air escaping, of sibilance in the grass and fratricidal insects that scurry over swollen raindrops, of the hound's sharp bark and the tree's gimpy sway. I rise slowly, raising chalice-like the plastic container that once held light ricotta. The instructions are clear. Lift flap. Use applicator stick to apply a very thin smear on oval one. Close flap. Repeat procedure thrice. Place an envelope and seal. Return to test giver address. Through the skylight, shadows grimace, hands on hips, peering down amid the nightshade. And the rest are from the collection that I'm working on right now, Repositories it's called. The bear. When you hear the sound of scraping beyond the cave's orifice to the outer world, think again before you enter. The warmth, the smell, the heady brew that may invite you into a place of origin, a place where fermentation lacks but your quick yeast. Inside, you may find luminescent walls covered with the true signs of art. Clasp, square, dove, vase. And the word rookgebard, rebirth. Millennia accordioned into a single moment from the rutted plateaus of Anatolia to the quick bog zones of the boreal north. Or you may find a creature squatting in the goddess pose. As agonized, she prepares to insert a careless child back into her womb. And are you next in line? One more sacrifice to help atone for that original chromosomal split? Best to hold back until the scraping ends, the walls pristine, the odors turn to must, the cave abandoned to bats and their echoes. And then to gingerly step in with lantern in hand to light the intimate corners where androgyny failed to stop the great divide. The bones gathered in ceremonial piles wait for their owners to claim them, totems for the journey that lies ahead, a way out of the maze that threatens to undo us all. Gather those marked for you. Prepare to carry them to where they no longer matter. Listening to a tender Azerbaijani novelist upon her dying grandmother. She sits in the corner, angled between two walls, on a slight wicker chair, dark hair glistening under harsh light. As she speaks, as she murmurs, she tastes the air, coal cascades in a torrent of black and salt, tattooing her face with the swirls of existence. Where is that universal language when you need it most? In the den. I'm met by a line of bitter dragons, fire sagging in the belly, tired, elongated faces littered with questions. What do they want to ask? What do they need to know? They turn from side to side, and the cramped, peculiar space, crowns budding the dour ceiling, flanks scraping the kinetic walls, as if unused to their own home, centipede legs barely able to carry that stratospheric bulk. What do they need to ask? What do they want to know? More and more, they fill the room like some sort of shrill metaphor, until a bluefin bus with insect antennae and wavering gills pulls up to take them all away. Only then, in this suddenly empty place, do I see the scribbles on the floor where the sour dragons shuffled. What do we want to ask? What do we need to know? What is sky? Devolution. It's a shallow hole. A horse lies on its flank, helpless, unable to move. Eyes wild, breathing fear like ribcage bellows. A woman with a kerchief and a microscopic brush combs the horse as if searching for something from tip of nose to end of mane, meticulous inch by inch, every speck inspected. She continues to do this until there is nothing left but a string of bones, half buried in unoxidized earth. Herself now breathing heavily, the woman wipes her brow and places a staked sign where the nose tip was. Equus ferus, last of its kind. And this is called A Visit to an Ice Cave. Imagine then a line of ancestors embedded in ice, their startled faces trapped in the moment deep freeze takes hold and time stops. Caught within this unlikely cave, a gelid force field to keep the warmth at bay. Do they stare out at the passage of clouds? Breezes bringing honey and goldenrods? A sun that seems well within reach? Can they yearn for such a touch? All it would take to get the clock ticking again is for one ray to find its way inside. One drip of water from a stalactite's tip. Imagine then a line of ancestors emerging through ice, a sudden release from stasis, inevitable rebirth, the shudder of a thaw into worlds without pause, where motion is constant and the engine burns and belches, unable to stop from devouring itself, where clouds are manufactured for the sole purpose of enticing those within to expose themselves, where sun, honey, and goldenrods extract the passing moment from forever and hold it out for the expiring to mourn. Best then to imagine the perfection of an empty space, a place of blinding darkness hollowed out by winds so ghostly they deflect the sunlight itself, a place that seals the ancestors in and makes them immune to life, a place with neither inside nor out, a place that can't be imagined. Imagine then what can't be imagined. These bones. Walls shape a goddess that has never known day or night, blind mole groping to read a braille universe. Chorus, I have carried these bones for as long as I can. The walls bleach light from the eyes of crows. Suddenly white, they chip into the heart of the unsuspecting. Feet embedded, wings derailed. There is nothing to which they can be compared, no matter how often you roll the language dice. Chorus, I have carried these bones for as long as I dare. Alabaster city carved from the tusks of unguent mountains, deep beneath a rosette sky that has never known sky, a wind that whistles in the dark tales of the outer world. Chorus, I have carried these bones as far as they will allow. And I'll read one more. To a poet struggling to recover her words, please note, this is not a metaphor. In the spongy gray room, walls reticulated, bony chair bolted to upheaving floor, spotlight at 10 flickers per second, she sits. There's a hole in the side of her head. There's a hole where they extracted the overeager building blocks, the out-of-control tidbits of DNA. The incisions were precise, one must assume, but it didn't prevent the words, her words, from escaping into the sterile air. Now, a saintly smile framing her face, she sits in the bony chair inside the spongy gray room with reticulated walls and reaches out to recapture the stray letters that may or may not have survived without her tender care. I sit across from her, spoon-feeding alphabet strands into a hungry mouth, fearful that the words that have kept her whole, that have defined her, that connect her to herself, that have built this gray room, will be unable to make the return journey. Please note, this has not been a metaphor. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
Hello, folks. To my immediate left is Darlene Sacks, and she's going to be playing the cajon, which is a beatbox. Bass player, acoustic bass, Kevin Jeffries. And lead guitar will be Sean Peevers. And so we've got some songs set up for you. Okay, this first tune is one called an old folky song. Just an old folk singer, I've penned some songs, so much I haven't learned as time goes on. And I've never been in a band, cause I've always sung alone, just sharing rhyme and reason in this old folky song. Singing tunes by Paxton, Bill Oakes and Seeger too, and those sing-alongs by Woody and Denver often woo. Singing them together in four-part harmony, we'll remember all those folk songs and sing in unity. Cause I'm just an old folk singer, and I have penned some songs, so much I have learned as time goes on. And I've never been in a band, cause I've always sung alone, just sharing rhyme and reason in this old folky song. I remember haunting places that I used to roam, the Iguana on 14 and the old 15 below. And opening for Johnny D so many years ago, and meeting some guy named Gordon at some old DC show. When I was young I rambled every here and there, I'd pack my axe upon my back and go without a care. Whether sitting on a beach somewhere or camping in the woods, I'd sing a line or two, just hoping they were good. Well,
Well, now that I'm over 65, I'm still singing them songs. Just a rockin' to that gentle beat, hoping you'll sing along. Playing on the Martin, at times my Epiphone. Just sharing life and all it has before I am long gone. 'Cause I'm just that old folk singer, and I love to sing those songs. So much I have learned as time goes on. And I've never been in a band, 'cause I've always sung alone. Just sharing rhyme and reason before I am long gone. Just sharing rhyme and reason in this old folky song. Thank you. Many years ago, I attempted to learn a song when I was a fledgling guitar player, and I could never figure out this song. And it's a Paul Simon tune that Simon and Garfunkel did. And so I haven't mastered it yet, but I've got most of it. We're going to do it for you right now. And it's called The Dangling Conversation. And I picked this today because this is a Poetry and Music Salon, and they talk about Emily Dickinson and Robert Frost in the song. And I love Robert Frost. So this is called The Dangling Conversation. It's a still I've walked to color of a now late afternoon, as the sun shines through the curtain lace and shadows wash the room. And we sit and drink our coffee, couched in our indifference like shells upon the shore. You can hear the ocean roar in the dangling conversation and the superficial sighs are the borders of our lives. And you read your Emily Dickinson, and I'm my Robert Frost, and we note our place with bookmarkers that measure what we've lost. Like a poem poorly written, we are verses out of rhythm, couplets out of rhyme, in syncopated time, lost in the dangling conversation and the superficial sighs on the borders of our lives. Yes, we speak of things that matter with words that must be said. Can analysis be worthwhile? Is the theater really dead? And how the room softly faded, and I only kissed your shadow. I cannot feel your hand, you're a stranger now unto me. Lost in the dangling conversation and the superficial sighs are the borders of our lives. Mm-hmm. Now, just so you know, only Sean and I have done that before. So it was a first for Kevin and a first for Darlene, but we had a good time with it. Anyway, now, at this point, I want to plug my CD. It's available in the back. It's $15, and it's a remake of the original LP I had put out in 1972 when I first got into all this music stuff. And
Kirk, you're only 39.
I know. My name's Jack Benny, actually. Anyway, you remember him? But this next song I'm going to do is on that CD. And on the CD, I do it as a solo. And now I have the whole band here. It's not really a band. We're just a bunch of good musicians that get together. First fret. Okay. Traveling down the highway, singing songs galore. Driving the open country, just a going by country store. Moving up the Yukon to see some friends I know. Isn't the North just beautiful if you see it as you go? So be yourself, I say, be a friend to me. 'Cause I've done everything that I can to be a friend to thee. Be yourself, I say, be a friend to me. Be a friend to everyone and just be free. From the Sound to the Berkshires to Connecticut you go. Singing songs together, just a singing as you go. Writing lines that seem to rhyme about things you've seen or done. Ho-ho! Sky's blue, grass is green, well, we're having so much fun. So be yourself, I say, be a friend to me. 'Cause I've done everything that I can to be a friend to thee. Be yourself, I say, be a friend to me. Be a friend to everyone and just be free. Well, now this trip is over, and I'm heading south, you know. Thinking over everything as slowly as I go. Wondering when I'll return again to this place in the north. Wondering if you'll ever come my way once more. So be yourself, I say, be a friend to me. 'Cause I've done everything that I can to be a friend to thee. Be yourself, I say, be a friend to me. Be a friend to everyone and just be free. La da 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 da. Now I'm on my way. La da 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 da. I'll return someday. La da 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 da. See you when I can. La da 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 da. La da 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 da. But I don't know when. I say la da 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 da. But I don't know when. Thank you. Thank you. That was the second song I had ever written, and it was way back in the early days, and I always thought it was a terrible song, but it's actually pretty good. Okay, this next song is one I wrote last year as a challenge at a songwriters group I was in, and the challenge was to write a verse and a chorus that you could teach somebody else. So I wrote the whole song. It's called Dusty Roads, because I was in going to be heading back to the States for a visit. And I visited my old home, and it was a great visit. So this is Dusty Roads. I'm sorry. That's my fault.
Well, I would have adjusted, but still.
I know, but you know. Okay. Many roads I have traveled to the places I have been. Trekked all around this world, so much to have taken in. But the best place I have ventured is that dusty one toward home. It's time to set my feet down, no more dusty roads to roam. Those old roads and the woodlands are the places that I love. Spent many an hour gazing at the clouds up above. But I find that I'm most happy sitting by a rambling stream, a place of contemplation where my love and I have been. Many roads I have traveled to the places I have been. Trekked all around this world, so much to take in. But the best place I have ventured is that dusty one toward home. It's time to set my feet down, no more dusty roads to roam. Well, I shared my life in literature, and I've shared my prose and song, and I've shared my time with others walking dusty roads along. It's time to put my feet up and kick back for a little while. This old guitar speaks of journeys together through the miles. Those dusty roads have taken me where others dare not go. Traveled up the mountains to the valleys down below. They've led me to the narrow pass, felt the wind upon my face. Opened up God's beauty in many a lovely my traveling days are few. I put away the fishing rods and the rough and the tumble too. I'm sailing in that easy chair, reminiscent of my life's run. All the dusty roads I've traveled and my time that's yet to come. Dusty roads are where I've traveled, dusty roads are where I've been. Dusty roads all around this world, so much to take in. But the best place I have ventured is that dusty road toward home. It's time to set my feet down to the place that I call home. It's time to set my feet down to the place that I call home. This next tune is one I wrote out in California and many years ago in the early 70s. And I was 27 days away from going from there back to where I came from. And I was in the military. And so I wrote this song. And many days I spent my daytime being a Marine, a U.S. Marine. And then in the evenings I was a hippie wannabe. But I couldn't mix them both, you know. Anyway, this is called 27 Days. Mm-hmm. sound good, doesn't it?
Oh, the mountains are rising beneath the open sky, and I'm 2,000 miles away. But the California sunsets just makes the time pass by, so I'll be home in 27 days. I met a lot of people from far away and near, and we get together once in a while, singing something easy and just sipping on some beer, sharing thoughts after many a long mile. And the mountains are rising beneath the open sky, and I'm 2,000 miles away. But the California sunsets just make the time pass by, so I'll be home in 27 days. Thinking of my hometown, well, you know just where I'd be, singing songs of travels to the sea, wondering for the happiness that I've been looking for, the open roads, the mountains, and McCuaig. And the mountains are rising beneath the open sky, and I'm 2,000 miles away. But the California sunsets just make the time pass by, so I'll be home in 27 days. Clock, it runs in circles, soon my time will come. The nights reach out just to touch the dawn. A chess game and a checkmate has been run, and I'm the king again, plus the pawn. And the mountains are rising beneath the open sky, and I'm 2,000 miles away. But the California sunsets just makes the time pass by, so I'll be home in 27 days. And the California sunsets just makes the time pass by, so I'll be home in 27 days. Yes, I'll be home in 27 days.
One more, yeah. Okay, well, I got one more to do. I'm going to leave you folks with a song of my wish for world peace. The song's called Whispering Peace. And with all the turmoil that's going on in the world today, we need peace. So this is a song I wrote in 1972. The wind across the straight line once whispered peace. Brothers and sisters, why can we not see that nations once united lay fallen to the ground, and millions of people wonder when this old world is finally gone, and we're before God's throne, all that He'll have to say to us is that you're condemned to burn. Because the wind across this great land
once whispered peace, and we're the ones who destroyed it all because we did not heed. Now, if only they would have listened to the words that Jesus said, love thy neighbor as thyself, then there'd be peace instead. But the wind across these great lands can no longer whisper peace, and we're the ones who destroyed it all because we did not heed. So come all ye people, listen to my plea. Let's sing that song together of love in unity, so that our unborn children can live in peace, and the winds across these great lands will once again whisper peace. Ooh, 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 la da da. Thank you so very much. Thank you, Brenda, for having us. It was lovely.
Thank you, everybody. Wonderful. Thank you so much.
I'd have been.